Once again, I would like to take the opportunity to thank Rabbi Warren Goldstein, the Chief Rabbi, to thank the people of his office, Rabbi Gary Pogron, Tracy, and Mrs. Kruger and Mrs. Zimmerman, all these wonderful, wonderful people who helped make the trip so special and were so attentive to every detail. Many of you know by now that I am a Moyel, and Baruch Hashem, I've had the great experience to be a Moyel for more than 40 years. Unfortunately, I started when I was very young. I was only 21. My father had passed away at the time. And at that time, I had to take over the support of the family. I supported my mother and my younger brothers and sisters. I supported my mother literally until 5 years ago when she passed away. So over the years, every Moyel has many, many experiences. But recently, a year and a half ago, something happened that was so incredible that's going to be the theme for our talk this evening. I got a call from a man by the name of Rabbi Yisrael Rosenfeld. Rabbi Yisrael Rosenfeld lives in Denver, Colorado. He was a machanach for many, many years. He was a teacher, and I am so grateful to him because he was one of the first teachers of my wife, Miriam, who grew up in Denver, Colorado. He helped start the Hillel Academy. He taught her for many years, as he did many of the boys and girls in Denver. And eventually he became a principal. He wrote a book on chinuch, training Jewish children. Over the years, his children moved to New York, and I had the zechus to do many of his grandsons. He called me in June and he said, could you please come to the shul in Far Rockaway and the White Shul and do the bris on my first great-grandson? I said, Rabbi Rosenfeld, I'll be honored, of course, to do this special bris in your family. I come early to the bris before davening, and he's there, and he says, Rabbi Krohn, I want to show you something. This is the becher that we are going to use, the kiddush cup that we are going to use at the bris. He said, it's very, very special to me. So I said to him, what makes it so special? So he said, when my parents got married in Chust in Hungary many years ago, the Satmar Rebbe Rabbi Yoel, he was the Masada Kedushin, he performed the marriage ceremony, and he gave them this becher. So this becher, this kiddush cup is very, very special. I said, oh, that's very nice. He said, no, but there's more to it than that. He says, do you know that I was in Auschwitz? I said, Rabbi Rosenfeld, I thought you're from Denver, Colorado. He said, no, I came there as a young man, and he rolls up his sleeves, and he shows me the numbers on his hand. He says, I want to tell you what happened when I was 15 years old. When I was 15, we were living in Chust, and suddenly, in the 1940s, the Germans, Yimach Shalom, they surrounded the city, and it became a ghetto. Nobody was able to come in, nobody was able to come out. And then their rumors started that we were going to be deported. My father said to me, we're going to be deported deeper into Hungary. Nobody in their wildest imaginations thought we were going to be deported to a concentration camp in Auschwitz. But I said to my father, no matter where they send us, they will never let us take the family valuables. Please, let me take some of the family valuables, I'll bury them someplace, and maybe hopefully we'll be able to come back here someday. And so I took the atara of my father's talis, I took the leichter, the candlesticks of my mother, I took my father's pocket watch, and I took the becher. And I ran around behind my grandmother's house where the earth was soft because they had chickens there. And I buried those four items. I dug with my hands as deep as I could, and I put in the atara of my father's talis, the leichter, the candlesticks, the pocket watch, and the becher. And 4 days later, we were deported to Auschwitz. We were there for a year and a half. My father was killed, my brothers were killed. The only ones that survived were me, my sister, and my elderly mother. My mother couldn't travel anymore. And after the DP camps, it took another 2-3 months till I was able to come back to Chust. And I came to Chust and I ran into the house that I grew up. And the goyim, they threw me out. They said, get out of here. If you don't get out of here, Jews don't belong here anymore. The houses don't belong to them. You don't get out, we'll call the police. I was frightened. I was less than 19 years old. I didn't want the police coming after me. So quickly I ran to behind my grandmother's house to try to figure out where I buried these items. And I figured it might be in this and this place. The earth was very hard already. I took a stick and I started digging and digging at the spot that I thought that they were at. And sure enough, that was the exact spot. And I found the atara of my father's talis, my mother's candlesticks, the pocket watch, and I found the brecha. But the brecha was flat because it had been on top and everybody had been stepping on it, not realizing what it was. I took it to a silversmith and eventually we remolded it. And this becher, he says, we have used it for every bris in the family, for every wedding. And today, we're going to use it for the first time for my first great-grandson. I was so touched. I took the becher and I kissed it. And I said, Brother Roosevelt, give me this becher before the bris. Because today, I want to talk about this becher before the bris, not after. And after davening, before they even brought in the baby, I told everybody the story that I just told you. And I held up the becher. And I said to everyone, this becher represents Klal Yisrael. This becher has been trampled on. This becher has been stepped on. This becher was given up for dead. But here it is in all its glory. I said, Klal Yisrael has been stepped on, trampled on, given up for dead, thrown out of different countries and different places in the world. But here we are, greater and bigger than ever. 95,000 people are going to show up at that time to the Sima HaShas. Look at this community all over, getting stronger than ever, learning more than ever, doing more mitzvahs than ever. This Becher represents Klal Yisrael. This is a Kesha of Bracha. And it would seem to me, I said to everyone in the shul that morning, that after the bris, everyone should line up and take a drink of the wine that all of us are going to be able to drink from. This is the Kesha of Bracha after the bris. And sure enough, after the bris, long line of people lined up, and everybody kept on drinking from the wine that we kept on pouring into this Kesha of Bracha. And I said to them, when I say to you, every one of us here can be a cup of blessing. Every one of us can be a Kesha of Bracha, and every one of us has to be a Kesha of Bracha. And I'll tell you why. Right in the beginning, when Hashem speaks to Avraham Avinu, take a look in Lech Lecha, you'll see. Hashem says, "V'esch l'goy gadol, I will make you to a great nation. V'amarecha, I will bless you. V'agad l'shemecha, I will make your name great." And then he says two words that should become our mantra from now on forever for the rest of our lives. Hashem says to Avraham, "V'heyei bracha, become a blessing." And Rav Samson Ful here says, most people think it means, "V'heyei bracha, you'll become a blessing, you'll be rich and famous." He says, that's not what it means. He says, God says to Avraham Avinu, become a blessing to the world. Give encouragement, give light, give chizuk, become a blessing. That's what every yid is supposed to do, that's what Avraham was supposed to do. Become an inspiration. And I'm going to show you today how every single man, woman, and child in this holy, we could call it a base medrash for this afternoon, can become that person a blessing. How do you become that? I want to tell you a story. Maybe some of you know the first part, but none of you could possibly know the second part. In January of 2009, there was a plane that left LaGuardia Airport. It's the second of two airports in New York. The plane was U.S. Air Flight 1549. The captain, the pilot, was a fellow by the name of Chesley Sullenberger. It sounds Jewish, but he's not Jewish. He's a brilliant aviation historian, and they were going to North Carolina, 150 people on board. He takes off from LaGuardia. Those of you who know LaGuardia, if you travel less than 1 minute, you're over the George Washington Bridge, over a body of water. And suddenly, the pilot realizes that he has no power. No power in the plane. The engines have been disabled. Why? Because two flocks of birds were sucked into the engines. And he radios to LaGuardia Airport. And he says, I've got no power. And they say, we'll close the airport, turn around the plane, bring it back, any runway you can land on. It's all yours, we'll shut the airport. He says, I can't even make it there. Less than a minute he was flying, and he doesn't have enough power to get back to LaGuardia. So they tell him, there's a small airport called Teterboro, which of course he knew, and anybody in New Jersey knows. Coast! Coast till Teterboro, we'll shut the airport. You'll be able to land on any runway in Teterboro. He says, I can't even make it to Teterboro. So now he had one of two choices. Either he can land a plane on one of the streets in New York and he'll kill everybody on board and many people in the field, in the streets, or the highway, or he could try to land in the Hudson River. Now he knew the only way you can land a plane in the water is if both wings hit the water at the exact same microsecond. Because he knew that other pilots had tried to land a plane and one wing hit the water first, it snapped off, exploded, and everybody was killed. And so as he makes this decision to land the plane in the Hudson River, he says three words to everybody on the plane: brace for impact. And with unbelievable concentration, and unbelievable siyata d'shmaya, and unbelievable skill, he lands the plane perfectly level into the water, and the plane coasts for a mile, and it stops, and he saved every single person on that plane. One of the greatest pictures that you will ever see, if you go online, you can see it. It's all those 150 people on the wing. If I was on that wing, I would have slipped right into the water. I don't know how anybody could have the wherewithal not to be so frightened on a freezing January day to stand on that wing until the boats of rescue came. Many people know this story. What they don't know is that the next year, on the anniversary of this plane incredible landing, they brought Captain Sullenberger back to the Hudson River. And as he stood by the banks of the river, they said to him, "Please, relive for us." How did you do it? How did you not lose your sense of concentration? How did you not just fall apart knowing that you had to land it in such a perfect way that 150 lives were in the balance? Listen to what he said. It's going to change your life forever, as I said last night. He said, "When I was a little boy, the one that was closest to me was my father. I loved my father more than anything in this world. And my father loved me more than anything in this world. And then, in my early teenage years, my father was killed in a terrible way, which I can't even describe to all of you. He said, I was so lonely. I was so frightened. I had such anguish and such pain. I didn't think I could live a day without my father. But as time went on, and I began living as a teenager, I swore to myself that for the rest of my life, I would make sure that no one that I knew, if I could help it, would ever go through the pain that I went through, being alone without somebody that I loved so much. And as I flew over the George Washington Bridge, all I could think of was my father. And all I could think of was the pain and the anguish that I felt when he wasn't there. And all I could think of was that if I don't land this plane perfectly level, hundreds if not thousands of friends and survivors and relatives of these 150 would go through the Gehenna that I went through. And so with tremendous concentration, as I thought about my father and I thought about avoiding the pain for these people, I was able to land that perfectly. I was able to land that plane in the water and saved everyone. And that's how Captain Sullenberger became a Kodesh Abraha. And that's how each and every one of us can become a Kodesh Abraha. You know how? Every one of us goes through challenges. If we look back into our lives and see how we were able to overcome certain difficulties in life, whether it was financial, whether it was family, whether it was health or shidduchim, whatever it is, however you survived it, by prayer, by networking, by planning. However you did it, go out and reach someone. Find someone who's going through what you went through. Put your arm around them and tell them, if I made it, you can make it. It's very difficult to give chizuk to somebody if you have not gone through what they went through. But any of us who have gone through pain in life, look at that pain, see how you overcame it, see how you conquered it, and go out and reach someone. And I'll give you an example. There's a fellow in England that I know who lives at Golden Street, who's got the worst job in Klal Yisrael. You know what the worst job in Klal Yisrael is? Being the head of the tuition committee for a yeshiva. That's the worst. Because you've got to argue with everybody. Everybody's got a reason why they can afford everything else, except they can't afford tuition for their children. It's amazing. Somehow, the things that are holy and mitzvahs, we don't have money for that. I know sometimes I come to a bris, the guy's got a caterer, he's got a DJ, he's got music, there's 150, 200 people at a bris, and he's bargaining with me for the price of the bris. And I say to him, I don't understand, sir, look around. He says, well, my father-in-law paid for all of this. So I said, well, maybe you can have your father-in-law pay for the oil. He says, well, that's my mitzvah. I said, because it's your mitzvah, I gotta suffer. So some, you know, for the holy stuff, you know, there's no money. So anyhow, this guy tells me that there was a fellow wealthy guy in England, in London, who owed the yeshiva £2,000. Now, it's very important to know, you know, the different languages. Pounds is dollars. And, you know, if you're from America, you've got to know that. See, there was once an English chassan that got married to an American girl. And during Shabbat, she came down wearing a beautiful dress, and he says, wow, you look like £1,000. For an American, that does not sound good. So you got to know what pounds and dollars and rand, you know, you got to know all these things. So anyway, so he calls this guy and he says, listen, you know, it's before Yom Kippur, it's before Pesach, and we got to pay the rabbeim, we got to pay the teachers. Please, you know you've been negligent, please come and pay. He says, you're right, I'm so sorry, I'll be there this afternoon. The fellow told me he waited for him a whole afternoon, the guy didn't show up, he could not believe it. The next day he's waiting for him again, he didn't want to call him, maybe something happened, he figured he'll come today. He didn't come, the guy had to go to the bank, he had to borrow money to pay the rabbeim before Yom Kippur. Now it's a few weeks before Shavuos, and he calls the guy, and he says, I don't understand you. You promised me you were going to come that afternoon, you know, I had to go to the bank, I had to raise money for the yeshiva to pay the manal, to pay the teachers, the rebbes. He says, what do you mean I came? He said, what do you mean you came? He said, what do you mean I came? It was very narrow streets, I couldn't park, your son was outside, I gave him an envelope with £2,000. He said he was going to go in and give it to you. He said, I don't understand you. You gave my son, a 7.5-year-old kid, an envelope unmarked with £2,000? What are you, crazy? He said, nobody was outside the house. He said he was going to give it to you. My son never gave it to me. I'll go and I'll ask him if he remembers anything like this. He hangs up the phone, he goes and looks for his son. He says, do you remember a few weeks ago somebody gave you an envelope? He said, Daddy, I know what you mean. He calls back, the guy says, listen, you got to admit, it was very negligent on your part to do this. I don't want to have to take you to a business, but... you know, there are a lot of religious people on this block. I'll go up and down, I'll ask if anybody found it. He goes up and down the block, house to house, finally knocks on the door. He says, excuse me, sir, did you find a white envelope? He says, what do you mean, with £2,000 in it? He says, how do you know? He says, well, you won't believe it. It was a few days before Yom Kippur, right? He says, yeah. He says, you know, that day I was laid off my job. I didn't know how I was going to go in and tell my wife, we don't have money for Yom Kippur, and I don't even have a job. I was walking up and down the block, and I didn't know how I could go in and tell my wife. All of a sudden, in front of my lawn, I see an envelope, unmarked, £2,000. I figured, God, thank you. One minute of your life, right on my lawn. And that's the money that I used for Yom Kippur. But now that you tell me that it belongs to the yeshiva, what's the question? Of course, I'll pay you back. I don't have a job. I'll pay you back in increments, but I'll pay you back. Oh, the guy was so relieved. He calls the wealthy guy. He tells him the whole story. You won't believe the guy didn't have money, and he found it, he used it, and he's going to pay it back. But he still doesn't have a job. Listen what the wealthy guy tells him. Tell him he can keep the money. I once went through what he went through. Tell him he should keep the $2,000. I'll bring you the $2,000 later this afternoon. And this time he came into the house. That's a Pesach Krohn. That's somebody who went through the Gehenna, the embarrassment of not having a job, and being frightened, how's he going to put bread on the table? He went through that so he could be a Pesach Krohn. And that's why he gave the money to somebody else. That's what a Pesach Krohn is. One of the greatest organizations that I am involved with. And it wouldn't hurt to start something like this here in South Africa. Nobody should ever have to know of it. It's an organization called Links. It's for children who have lost a parent in their teenage years. There are today over 300 of those families where fathers or mothers died during their children's teenage years. Now, I know what it means to be without a father. I think anybody who loses a parent before they get married is considered a real yasim and atayra, a yasayva, an orphan. And so I got involved with this organization called Links. And I remember the first meeting, there were 35 girls there. It's more for girls than it is boys. Now for boys, they opened a separate organization. And I said to them, I know what it means to be without a father, or without a mother, without both parents. How would you like that I should give you a bracha every Friday? And the girl said, well, that would be a good idea. Do we have to call you? I said, no. There's a company, I'll make a recording on Thursday. Friday, 1 o'clock, every one of you girls will get this bracha. It's a 2-minute bracha, there'll be something on the parsha, and then you'll get it at 1 o'clock every Friday. Out of the 35 girls, 20 raised their hand, they would like to register. Fine, I took down their names and their telephone numbers, and the first week I made a bracha for them on Thursday. I get a printout, Friday afternoon, about 4 o'clock. 20 girls had registered, only 10 picked up the phone. I was surprised. They said they wanted to get the bracha. How come 10 didn't pick up the phone? And the next week, more and more girls registered. And all the time, only half the girls picked up the phone. I couldn't understand it. And so I called Sarah Rivka Cohen. Sarah Rivka is the one who started this organization. She lost her mother when she was 9. So she understands what it means to be without a beloved parent. Today she's married with children and she started this organization with her husband Shmuley. I said, Sarah Rivka, these girls registered. Why don't they pick it up? And when she explained it to me, I started crying. She said, you know why they don't pick it up? Because they want it on their cell phone machine so they can listen to it 4 times before Shabbos. Today, over 300 Yisraelim and Yisraelis get that bracha. That's how many girls and boys listen to it. There are some women who tell me that at 1 o'clock the house stops. They wait for the call to get that bracha. There's some fathers who tell me that the children listen to it, and Friday night they use this as the bracha or the dvartorah that they use at the table. How did I get involved? Because I went through that. Because I know what it means to be in a member of a single parent family. That's why I'm involved with Samchenu. Samchenu is an organization. Again, we should start it here for Almanas. Over 800 Almanas in that organization. Every year we have a Shabbaton. 800 from age 20 to age 80. And we come together. Who started it? 3 Almanas. Because they saw what it meant to be alone like this. They all come together every Shabbos and they have trips for them at different age levels throughout the week, throughout the year rather. That's what it means. That's what it means being Vehayei Bracha. Those women, Shani Stefanski, Chani Hershkowitz, and Brandi Hamstam, they went through the Gehenna of being alone, so they started an organization for those people that are alone. That's how you become a Kaisha Bracha. But you know what becoming a Kaisha Bracha means? To validate others. Give chizuk to others. There's a fellow in New York. His name was Eliezer Geltzer. Tall, good-looking Chassidish fellow was a Rosh Hashiva. Levach was killed in a terrible bus accident in Eretz Yisrael. 2 years later, his daughter Chana Malka is driving on the Garden State Parkway and she stops to get gas. And as she's getting gas, there's a midget. He's the one who's pumping the gas, a dwarf. And as the nozzle is in the hole there and it's filling up the car, he looks into the window and he sees a big picture of Rabbi Geltzer. And he says to Chana Malka, you know that man? She says, what do you mean, do I know that man? That was my father. He says, what do you mean that was your father? He says, well, 2 years ago he was killed in a tragic bus accident in Israel. And this midget starts crying. And she says, you knew my father? He says, I've been waiting for him for 2 years. He says, everybody who comes in to get gas, they don't look at me. They're afraid of what I look like. I know I look strange. I'm a midget. And even when they paid me the money, they avert my eyes. But your father came in here 2 years ago. He looked me straight in the eye like nobody ever did. And he said to me, you are an inspiration. You were born with a handicap that many people would consider severe and be ashamed. But you have overcome that handicap. You come here every day, you pump gas, you provide for yourself and for your family. You are a role model. He says, I'm the head of a big school. I am going to go now to the school and I'm going to tell everybody about you, how special you are. Because you have overcome that handicap. And then the midget begins crying again and he says to Chana Malka, your father made me feel tall. That's validation. That's chizuk. People go through difficulties. There's so many people in this room today that are going through difficulties. Put your arm around them. Give them chizuk. Tell them they're special. Validate them. One of the worst things that ever happened in New York, some of you may know, 2 years ago, there was a little boy, a 9-year-old boy, Leiby Klutsky, that was kidnapped. Terrible, and he was killed in a terrible way. I remember before he was killed, everybody, every stripe of Jew was looking for that little boy who was coming home from a summer camp, and Nebuch was kidnapped. And Nebuch, when everybody found out what happened, of course the family began sitting shiva, and I couldn't make up my mind. Should I go be Menachem Lobo the Kletskys? I didn't know Nachman Kletsky, the father. I didn't know the family. But everybody was involved. Everybody was doubting. Everybody was looking for that little kid. So I decided, you know what? I'm going to go just like everybody else. It's a long line of people. Everybody came in to say, I'm looking for Nachman. And as I walked by Nachman Kletsky, just like everybody else, he says, wait a second, you stop. I said, what, you know me? He said, my son Leiby used to watch your videos on Tisha B'Av. He said, sit down, talk to me. And I sat and I became a very, very close friend of his. As a matter of fact, when they had the monument, the setting of the monument, there was only 12 or 13 people. I was one of them that he wanted there. And he tells me, go in and talk to my wife. A few weeks later, he calls me up and he tells me, you know what happened after you left? Somebody came into my wife and said, Mrs. Kletsky, I want to thank you. So she says, why do you want to thank you? So the lady says, because I also have a 9-year-old son. And a few weeks ago, he started rebelling. And he stopped wearing tzitzis. And we didn't know what to do for him. We tried to give him gifts. It still didn't help. We punished him. It didn't help. And then when your son was missing, all of a sudden, one day, he comes down and he's wearing his tzitzis. So I said to my son, I'm happy you're wearing tzitzis. Why did you stop wearing tzitzis? He said, so they should find Leiby. So for 2 days, he wore tzitzis. And then when everybody found out what happened, I didn't know if he was going to wear his scissors. I didn't want to go up to his room to ask him. But he came down and he was wearing them, and he's been wearing them ever since. So I just want to thank you, Mrs. Kletsky, because of your son, my son started wearing scissors again. Listen to this, you won't believe it. 2 weeks later, Nachman Kletsky calls this woman and calls the little boy. And Nachman told me that when the little boy walked in, he gave him a kiss on his head, and he said, this kiss is not for me, this kiss is for my son, Leiby. And he sits down the boy and the mother, he says, I want you to know we're so proud of you that you started wearing tzitzis. Because it means so much to us that you were wearing them, that they should find my son. And he takes out a pair of Leiby's tzitzis and he gives it to this 9-year-old boy. He says, wear it every day, l'zecher nishmas, my son. And every day, including this morning, every day this 9-year-old boy, I spoke to myself, he puts on the tzitzis and he says, L'zecher nishmas Leiby Kletsky. Nachman Kletsky is a kosher bracha. He lost his only son. He has 4 daughters. And instead of thinking only about his pain, what does he do? He goes out and he does an act of inspiration that the family will never forget. That's what a kosher bracha is all about. And you know what a kosher bracha is all about? Giving chizuk not only to others, but to yourself. Sometimes you have to give yourself chizuk. A person goes through difficulties in life, and if somebody else gives you chizuk, that's wonderful. But it may not be long-lasting. But if you can give chizuk to yourself, then a person can carry on. Listen to this. There was a fellow who got divorced. He comes to my house, and he says, Rabbi Krohn, I want you to know I could not find myself. It took me a while till I found the shidduch, and then the marriage was over. We only married a short time, and I was absolutely beside myself. I went to Rabbanim, I went to therapists, nobody could tell me anything. And finally, I heard a CD from a Rav, and he says the following. Every morning we make the bracha. Sha'asa li kol tzarchi. Hashem, you have provided all my needs. You know what, anybody here know what you're supposed to think of when you make that bracha? Sha'asa li kol tzarchi? Who knows? What are you supposed to think about? You're supposed to think about that Hashem gave you shoes. Shoes? Shalosomli Kotzerki, Hashem gave me all my needs as shoes. And the Mishnah explains, you know why? Because without shoes, you're grounded. You can't go to shul, you can't go to work, you can't go to the store, you can't do anything. Without shoes, you're grounded. That's what it means. But somebody once went to the Rebbe of Zisha and said, Rebbe, you're so poor, you don't even own a pair of shoes. How can you make the bracha Shalosomli Kotzerki? You don't even have money that you can borrow shoes. How could you make that bracha shalosomli kol tzarchi? Listen to what he said. He said, imagine the king has a beautiful suit that's worth $1,000. And now, he wants to sell it for $300. So a guy buys the suit and it's too big. Not a problem. You go to the tailor, he takes it in, fits perfect. What if it's too tight? Also not a problem. Go to the tailor, he takes it out, it's perfect. So now this great $1,000 suit, he's got it for $300. But what happens if it's a pair of shoes? If the king wears a size 7 and you wear a size 10, there's nothing that you can do with that pair of shoes. And if the king wears a size 10 and you wear a 7, it's also no good. You can't do anything with a pair of shoes. Shoes have to be made exactly to your fit. He says, that's what you're supposed to think about, Zot Ramzisha. Any situation that you have in life, Sha'os Aliko Turki Hashem has put me in that position exactly like a pair of shoes. That situation was made specifically for me at that moment. And that's what the guy said. Then I understood that difficulty that I feel right now that I'm divorced, that was designed for me at that moment. God is testing me at this moment. How do I relate to him in this difficult time? And many of us who go through difficult times should say this bracha. Underline it in your sinner tonight. So tomorrow when you say it, you're also called Turkey. You know that God made this situation for you right now because he wants to see how you relate to him in this case. Doesn't mean it can't change. We could all have things can become much better, and it should be better. But right now, no, Sha'asa Likal Turki, don't be broken, because this was designed specifically for you. So I want to show you something, and all of you have this, hopefully, on your seats, and you'll always remember this. There was a fundraising seminar recently in New York, and one of the fundraisers got up, and he put this on the board. Hopefully you can see it on the screens, or you'll see it on your cards. SW3rd power/N. And he said, this is what fundraising is all about. Nobody knew what he was talking about. And I say, not only is this what fundraising is all about, this is what life is all about. You know what this means in fundraising? SW3rd power/N. Some will, some won't. So what? Next. That's what life is all about. You go fundraising, some will give you money. Some won't give you money. So what? Don't be broken. Go next to the guy. Next fellow. Sometimes you want to be among friends. Some will accept you. Some won't accept you. So what? Next. Sometimes you're trying to get a job. Some will give you the interview. Some won't give you the interview. So what? Next. A Jew should never be broken. There are always other opportunities. I recently had to speak for 100 divorced men and women. I told them, some marriages will work out, some won't work out. So what, this? It's not the end of the world. I said to all those divorced people, don't say to yourself you're a failure. Every day you should say, I am not a failure. My marriage failed. But that doesn't mean I'm a failure. You go right to next. The name of that topic was, by shame, a gift. Of the gift of second chances. So my grandson said to me, Zadie, Bayou Shady was also destroyed. So I said that, but it lasted longer than the first one. But it still is a great topic, and this is a great thought to remember. Take home the card with you, put it on your refrigerator, and never be broken. There's another thing. You know what it means to be a Kaisha Bracha? You take a look and Mishnah Abayis, Perek Vav Mishnah Gimel tells us, Noisei Bamoel Chaveira, carry the burden of your friend. And you take a look at the Tveres Yisrael and it'll tell you, Oiskuf Gimel, note 103, there are four ways that you can carry the burden of your friend. Become a Kaisha Bracha. One, Tichas Akuf, physical labor. You see an old lady carrying your package, you go over here, let me help you. You see an elderly couple trying to build a sukkah, you send your kids, you send yourself, help them build the sukkah. Physical labor. Another way is exhaust money. Help them. Get them a job. Give them some money. Lend them some money. The third way is incredible. Tzar nafshi. Feeling the pain. There's some people that are going through an illness. We are not doctors. But you can feel their pain, and I'll tell you how you can feel their pain. Some people are financially strapped, and you're not a philanthropist, you're not a wealthy person, you can't help them, but Tzar Nafshei, you know what Tzar Nafshei means in my opinion? What we spoke about this morning, tefillah, daven. We could all daven for another person in pain. I'll tell you a story that a fellow, Moshe Schlupper, told me. Some of you may remember in 1976, that was the year of Entebbe, July 4th. It's a great holiday in America, July 4th, the Day of Independence, but that was when a plane was hijacked and it was taken to Uganda. And there was a terrible person, Idi Amin, who had slaughtered thousands of his countrymen. And he threatened to blow up that plane that came from Israel. Everybody in Israel knew somebody who knew somebody who was on that plane. And they decided to make a Yom Tefillah, a day of prayer. And it was going to be held in the Mir Yeshiva. And Rav Chaim Shulevitz, who was alive at that time, he was going to lead the davening. He was going to lead the tilling. And he comes into the big base medrash of Mir. Thousands of people were there already. Yubilite, Chevron Nikailo, single boys, business people, everybody was there waiting for Rav Chaim to come in. And he comes in through the back and he sees this unbelievable crowd. And he's so taken by it, he's so overwhelmed, he sits down and he starts crying. And everybody's quiet, just listening to the great Rav Chaim Shulevitz, how he's crying. And then finally he makes his way up, down the long center aisle, he touches the Aron Kodesh, he kisses it, then he faces the Olam. Again, he looks out at this unbelievable crowd, and once again he falls apart and he starts crying. And when he takes hold of himself, Moshe Sukkah said, he said one sentence. That was the only sentence that he said. And he said the tilling was so great that every time he thinks about it, he still gets the chills after all these years. You know the one sentence Rav Chaim said? David! As if it was your father, or your mother, or your brother, or your sister that was there. And that's how we have to daven. Don't daven for 25 people. It doesn't mean anything. It's just a roll call. Daven for two or three people that need a refuah. Daven for two or three people that need shidduchim. Daven for two or three people who need parnas. And imagine the gehenna of the family when a father is sick and he's on chemo. Daven when there's somebody that's looking desperately for a shidduch for their child. Daven if it was your sister that was looking for a shidduch. That's how you become a kosher bracha. Think of other people as if it was your family member. That's what Sarnafshay is all about. And you know, I brought each of you a gift. A gift that Rabbi Warren Goldstein happens to be one of the people that helped me. And that is a DVD about how to do Bikur Cholim properly. All of you should have it on your seats. If not, they should be waiting outside for you. The DVD was made by my dear son-in-law and I on Bikur Cholim. And there's a great skit how not to do Bikur Cholim. Don't go to the Cholim and say, your doctor, that was the doctor of my aunt, Mashallah. But that was the doctor of my uncle, may he rest in peace. If you don't think that's the right doctor, that's fine. But don't tell it to the person who's sitting in the hospital bed. So take a look at that DVD. And if we don't have enough, I will send to Rabbi Goldstein's and everybody in South Africa will be able to have. I have a friend who sponsored over 30,000 of them. You know what part of Bikur Cholim is? Davening for the person. Listen to this unbelievable story. Rav Moshe Feinstein, he once came to visit Rav Shlomo Hyman, who was the Rosh Hashiva of Torah Vadas at the time. Now the doctors had just told one of the Talmidim, Rav David Bender, who was watching his Rebbe, Rav Shlomo Hyman, don't allow anyone to come in. Because your Rebbe is so frail. If he sees anyone, it could upset him in any which way. And he could die. He says, I will not allow anybody to come in. The doctor leaves. 5 minutes later, here comes Rav Moshe Feinstein. The God Lander, big tzaddik. How in the world are you going to tell Rav Moshe? No, thank you. The doctor said you can't come in. But that's the doctor's orders. So he says, Rosh Hashiva, I'm so sorry. But the doctor just gave me the orders that nobody's allowed to come in. You know what Rav Moshe said? You know what part of Bikur Cholim is? Not only visiting the person, davening for the person. So today, my mitzvah is davening. He stands outside the hospital room, he didn't go in. He davened for a few minutes, and then he left. He said, that's the mitzvah. And you know what it says in Shulchan Aruch? Part of Bikur Cholim is davening for the person. That's Tzar Nafshut. Take a look, you will see six wonderful rabbanim. And Rabbi Warren Goldstein is one of them. They speak directly to the Cholim. Take it to somebody who's not well and show it to them. Let them watch it. It's impossible not to cry by some, how so are the sincerity of some of these special people. They talk directly to the Cholim. That's what Bikur Cholim is all about. And if Chas V'Shalom somebody had a heart attack, you're the one who can help and give chizuk to somebody who had a heart attack. Somebody goes through a kidney transplant, somebody goes through a liver transplant, whatever it is. Somebody who hasn't gone through it can't say, hey, you're going to be okay. You're not God, you don't know. All you can say is you're godly for them. But if you went through that difficult operation, you're the one who has to go to the hospital. You're the one who has to be able to give chizuk to that person. That's what it means, Geisha Bracha. So I just want to end with a great story. Listen to this. What does it mean to be a Kodesh Shabrocha? You got to give me 2 more minutes, okay? It says, please finish, but, you know, this is the last speech before Mincha, without the Mincha here. So I'll tell you 2 great stories, and with that we'll close. There's a guy, Yossi Pressburger, who passed away at 47 years old. So many people went to be Menachem Mogolim. He was a great tzaddik, a great malchesed. Somebody comes into Mrs. Pressburger. She knew the sister of Yossi. She didn't know Yossi. She says, tell me one thing about Yossi. He always did chesed, right away. He never delayed. This woman says, thank you very much. I will try to remember that, because she was telling about her husband how he always did a favor right away. She drives 5 blocks away, the corner of Avenue N and East 19th, Kamenetz Yeshiva is on the corner. She told me she was in a line of traffic that had been a snowstorm. She couldn't stop. She sees a lady sitting and just sleeping, waiting, obviously, for her son, who's coming out of school soon. She said to me, but there was something in my heart that told me there's something wrong with that woman. Somehow, how her head was arched back. I just felt there was something wrong, but I couldn't stop the car because there were too many cars behind me. There was a light, only one row of traffic. So I called on Tzava, and I said, please forgive me. Please forgive me, but I think there's something wrong with the lady on East 19th and Avenue N. And Hatzala says, don't ever ask forgiveness from Hatzala. Have rahmanis on the victim. Don't have pity on us. We'll be there in a minute. And she drives off. A half hour later, she gets a call. Are you the lady who called Hatzala? She says, yeah. She says, I want you to know you saved her life. She was in diabetic shock. You were right. There was something wrong with her. She had hypoglycemia. If she had been there another 10 or 15 minutes, she could have died. Imagine that. She just heard. Try to do a chesed right away. That's what she did. 3 months later, she got another call from the mother of the lady who was sleeping. She said, we've been waiting 3 months to make this call. You didn't save one life, you saved 2 lives. My daughter was expecting a baby, and today she had a little girl. That's what being a Kodesh Shabrocha is. Let's just finish with this unbelievable, uplifting story. I came to the SINAI RSA, 95,000 people. I'm sitting in the audience like everybody else, and a guy, I never saw the guy in my life, Akiva Serebrowski, he says, Rabbi, I want to tell you why I'm here today. I want to tell you a story. I love when people, they want to tell me a story. So many of you told me that already. It's great. That's how the books get published. I'm a nice guy. I listen to everybody, but 98 out of 100 I can't use. But I listen to everybody. So anyway, he says, I'm here because of a third grader named Josh Siegel. I said, a third grader? He says, yeah, he's right there. Today he's 19 years old. Let me tell you what happened. He says, I came back from Miriam Yeshiva. I was so inspired from the learning in the Yeshiva in Eretz Yisrael. I wanted to become a Rebbe. I want to teach Jewish children Torah. So I'm a New Yorker. I looked around trying to get a job, couldn't get a local job. I got a job in Edmonton, Alberta. Edmonton is right next to the moon, for those of you who don't know. Edmonton, Alberta, the other side of the world. Okay? Menorah Day School. He says, I come and I'm teaching the third graders, and these kids are so into it, and I'm inspiring them and their parents. You know, it's my first year of teaching. I was so into it. I was teaching them Chumash. Near the end of the year, I decided, you know what? These kids are so into it, I gotta teach them Mishnayos. But I gotta give them an introduction about Mishnayos. So I put on the board all Shisha, Sidra, Mishnah, all the names of all the Masechtas. And I said, this is called Shas. And these kids are blown away. Shas, wow, so big. And I said to the boys, there are some rabbis who know all of Shas, they can't believe it. And I said, I'll bring you pictures of Pizza Nigga, Rabbi Shah, Rabbi Yashah, Rabbi Yashah, they know all of Shas. Well, these kids were blown away. He says, everything was great until recess. Recess, I'm sitting marking papers, all the kids went out, 2 kids are in the classroom. They're talking, Josh Siegel and another kid. Josh Siegel says to another kid, you think our rabbi knows Shas? So the other kid says, of course not, he's too young. So Josh said, but he's a rabbi. He's a rabbi, he's got to know Shas. So Rabbi Serebrowski said, he's smiling the innocence of these children. So the other kid says, okay, let's go ask him. And he thought to himself, how in the world am I going to tell these kids that I did not learn Shas? If I tell them, I'm on a pedestal now. And if I tell them I didn't learn Shas,
you know, I'll fall off the pedestal. You know, go home and say, yeah, Rabbi's not special. I'll lose the influence that I even have on the parents. So he said, I thought of a story. Rabbi Pesach Kamenetsky was once in a home on Yontif, on Pesach. And he wasn't so sure about the kosherness of the home. I mean, it was kosher, otherwise they wouldn't have put him there. But the lady served the dish, so he said, I don't eat kibrots. Really, he did. But like this, he got out of it, so he didn't have to eat it. And he said that the Shari Tshuva says that if somebody is makabel, somebody undertakes to do a mitzvah, and he does it a little while later, he gets the reward for the time that he undertook the mitzvah. So tonight, if anybody undertakes a certain mitzvah, even if you do it in a few months from now, you get the reward from tonight on, because at the time that you undertook it. So he says, if these guys come over to me and ask me if I'm going to learn Shas, I make a promise right now. I'm going to start the Daf Yomi at the next cycle, and I'm going to finish Shas. Josh Siegel comes over to him, says, Rabbi, did you learn Shas? He swallows and he says, yes. Josh Siegel goes back to the other kid and says, see, I told you. And at the next start of the cycle of Shas, he starts learning every day. Eventually he moved to Toronto. And he told me that some days he had to be up at 4:30 in the morning to make sure that he was able to learn the daf. Some days he was up 12:30 at night. But after 6.5 years of doing the daf every day, and he knew the Siyam HaShas was coming, he decided, I'm going to bring Josh Siegel to the Siyam HaShas. But I don't know where he is. So he calls his mother in Edmonton. He says, do you remember who I am, Rabbi Sarah Browski? Where is Josh today? He says, Josh is learning in Israel. He's learning in Arsameach. Oh, I couldn't believe it. Josh, the third grader, is learning Torah in Israel. Wow. He calls Mrs. Siegel. He says, I want to bring him. I want to bring him to the Siyam HaShas. I'm buying the best ticket, but I can't afford to bring him in from Israel. She says, don't worry. For you, I'll do it. And she brings him in. And he meets him at Newark Airport. And he takes him to the Siyam HaShas. And he introduces me to him. And I say, Josh, do you remember this story? He says, not a word. Of course, how can he remember? He's a third grader. But he's singing and dancing together with his Rebbe. And it was the most emotional moment. Two most emotional moments. One, the quietness of Mincha, 95,000 people davening quietly. And the second, the singing and dancing, everybody with the talmidim and their kids in place. And what I can't get over was after the Siyam, you know what he does? He takes Josh and he takes him to Beis Medrash Gevoya Lakewood. And for the next 2 days, they learn Daf Beis and Daf Gimel and Brachas. And then he brings him back to Newark Airport and he sends him back there to Israel. That's a Klesha Bracha. Somebody who gives inspiration, somebody who gives of his heart, somebody who gives to others. Tonight, let's make a commitment at this final session of this great, great kiddush of Sinai Rsa. What a schus it is for all of us to be at this holy conclave. There's no question in Shemayim that our parents and grandparents are smiling. That Klaus of the Seichel to have such a role like Rabbi Goldstein that came up with this great idea of Sinai and Dava. He deserves a tremendous round of applause. Let us make a commitment. As we said last night, we are all members of Hashem Symphony Orchestra. Every one of us is a musician. Again, I don't have to be like you, you don't have to be like me, and both of us don't have to be like him. Every one of us is a musician in God's symphony. Every one of us should make a commitment to Avos HaTorah, Avos Yisrael, Yir Shamayim, Ve'nodu L'chaver, Ve'nodu L'amok, and that's what it's all about. Let's remember that story that I told you last night about Rabbi Avigdor, the father looking for children. God is looking for us. He wants to come close to us. This is the way to become close. To have such a great conference, to have such a great kiddush, and make a commitment. We've come to listen, to absorb, and to commit. Let us commit to Avos Hashem and Avos Yisrael. We'll be zeichah then to see Mashiach in our time. I love every one of you. Thank you for inviting me. And thank you for listening.